infection control training at our school. So Dr. Puttaiah, hello, how are you?
Fine, Glenn. How are you guys?
I'm doing good. And you know, we had a conversation earlier because of what's going on right now. Obviously, I don't even have to really bring it up, but there's so many things that the coronavirus is doing right now, just kind of disrupting our way of life, but also our practices as well. And I reached out to Dr. Puttaiah and I was like, look, Dr. Puttaiah, here's the thing. We understand it's a serious thing, but you know what is also serious is the fact that, okay, we're going to close for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. But I told you, it was like deep down inside, I feel like 3 weeks, it's going to be longer than 3 weeks. But there's so much misinformation. Obviously, this is a scary situation, but there's so much misinformation out there. But before we get started, for those who don't know who Dr. Puttaiah is, Dr. Puttaiah, can you kind of just do a quick intro of who you are and what your credentials are and why you're kind of an expert in this field?
Hold on. Let me just pull up my vitae. I mean, it's got a few pages. No, I'm just kidding. Okay. I'm actually a public health dentist. I'm a trained epidemiologist. I used to be a shoe leather epidemiologist in chronic diseases, oral cancer. I used to kind of go ahead and screen people at their doorsteps and, you know, 30,000 people, you know, over the past, over 3 years or so. Later, I came to the U.S., got a degree in epidemiology, did a, you know, residency in dental public health. And that was right at the time when HIV and AIDS was a big thing. So I was offered a fellowship, postdoctoral fellowship in infectious diseases at UT Health Science Center in San Antonio under the training of Dr. James Cotone. It was a J&J fellowship. So I spent 4 years out there, and then I joined Baylor College of Dentistry as a tenure-track professor. And about 4 months ago, I retired as a tenured professor from Texas A&M College of Dentistry. And I've been, I mean, for the past, let me say, 28 years, all I've been doing is, you know, didactic teaching, research, federal funding, and you call it infection control, OSHA, and dental safety, basically.
Well, thank you, Dr. Puttaiah. And like I said, you are one of my instructors with so many people that's in this group have been you've been instructed by you. But like I said, I wanted to bring you on because there's so much misinformation out there, right? I mean, we can't even, it's so frustrating. I told you how frustrating it is that we can't even agree with each other. The ADA has says something, the TDA says something, everyone else says anything. But you know, there's certain facts that we can't argue with, right? And that is, what is the appropriate protection. So we have a question here. And guys, if you have questions, please put it in the comment section. Dr. Puttaiah, he literally has been doing interviews and podcasts all day long. And I'm really grateful to get him on here in his busy schedule. But Dr. Puttaiah, let's take one question really quick, and then we'll just dive into the actual protective gear that we should be wearing and who we should be seeing and all those things. Let's just go ahead and just dispel all those myths. Let's take this one question here. This question is, do you recommend closing, seeing only emergencies across the nation? Dr. Puttaiah.
Well, my answer is going to be a double-edged sword. Okay. Number one, we are not people walking on the street. We are all trained dental professionals. That's what I presume. I wouldn't walk into your clinic if you were not trained in infection control and safety. I mean, I wouldn't. The second thing is it becomes human emotion. And then the third thing is rules and regulations. Most of the time, it's more like a suggestion or a guideline. We are not a restaurant where we're going to see 50 plus people or more. I wish we were. You know, we'd be really doing really good. So what I'm saying is, yes, for what the government says, what the associations say, they say it very cautiously because it applies to everybody. It's not purely for dentistry. It is not purely for restaurants. It's not purely for individual people. So we got to think that we are better trained as long as we apply it. I mean, it's a simple thing. 2002, 2003, when we had SARS, people wanted to close everything down. Yeah, our school was open. We had a skeletal staff running each department. You know, yeah, we saw emergencies, and if we also had a screening procedure right in front. If you're not feeling good, you know, if you're not going to be, you know, if you think that you're not feeling good, don't come in. Then you ask screening questions on who the contacts were in the recent past. Did they have any hospitalization? What did they have as far as, I mean, just think about it, any immunocompromising condition. It goes both ways, this disease. We can infect them, they can infect us. Now, of course, emergencies, if somebody's got a really big abscess and they already had been to Wuhan or whatever it is and they're already there, we'd send them straight to Baylor Medical Center. Of course, right. It's a walkthrough, you know, down the street. Yes, you can open it. But be cautious in the sense, you can't close all the clinics for the next 6 weeks. What if it goes to 6 weeks?
And, you know, that's something we talked about, Dr. Puttaiah, because I think that most of us, and for those who are watching, thank you for tuning in and ask your questions. This is the time to actually ask a legitimate expert here. But Dr. Puttaiah and I had that conversation, and I told him my gut feeling is it's going to be way longer than 3 weeks, possibly going into the summer. So there's a lot of things that come into effect. I told him, and I'm going to tell everyone here that's watching, that this is going to be a new norm, guys. This is going to be a new norm. So you got two choices. You actually got three choices. You can kind of close your offices and hope for the best. You could just not care and just open your office and do whatever you want, or you can adapt. And that's a reason why I wanted to bring Dr. Puttaiah on today, because let's say it goes beyond, Dr. Puttaiah, let's say it goes beyond 3 weeks, okay? And you can only see emergency patients, right? Well, 3 weeks, 6 weeks, you know, and then so on and so on, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, time goes on, and all those things that were elective procedures, are they really elective procedures at that point?
No.
No, they're not. No. You know, you leave, we lecture our patients all the time about their perio, and we're going to tell them to, hey, don't worry about it, and until you can come back, who knows, 3 months from now or whatnot. So in those cases, I mean, what are we supposed to do? Let's say if it goes beyond 3 weeks, Dr. Puttaiah, what do you, I mean, and it becomes like a new norm, what are we supposed to do?
You know, I wouldn't venture out that far. I would say, you know, just follow simple control measures. Number one is communication. Okay. Number two is control measures. Prior to the next day, I would request all your office, front office, to call all the patients and leave a message or talk to them and say, if they're not feeling well, don't come in. Mm-hmm. If they've had any high risk exposures, don't come in. Now, most of the people don't know in this case whether they were exposed to a person, because it's always a 20-20 hindsight, you know. But if they're feeling well, and if it's not a very high splash spatter procedure, sure, you can do it.
Okay.
You know, if it's an emergency, definitely come in, you know. You guys, then that is one thing. Then on your website, put a posting. On your front door, put a small sheet which says, if you're not feeling well or if you have had blah, 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 high risk, don't come. Call us. We can schedule a thing. But if you're in severe pain and you need to come, do come in. Mm-hmm. At that time, you have to man your office. Number two is skeletal crew. You don't have to have seven ops. If you have a large office, you don't have to have all the seven ops open. You know, you can have three ops which can be run efficiently. You don't have to have 20 people working at the time. You could have 10, you see. Then you have work practice control measures. Now, when the patient comes in, your front office. Now, another thing is most offices don't have a shield for the front office,
right? Kind of like how you go to a bank, right? That window at the bank teller.
Yeah, just like a bank teller, but not that bad. At least it should be better than, you know, a food court kind of a thing.
Sure.
You know, where you have a food covering. It's called a cough guard or a sneeze guard. Yeah. Number one, before they sign in, they can be asked, you know, three or four critical questions. One, have you how are you feeling? Are you feeling sick? Number two, any family members who have been sick in the past few days? Have you had a hospitalization? Have you been to any high-risk area? Now, explain to me which is a high-risk area. The whole world is a high-risk area today.
Yeah.
So that's a redundant question. You know, when Ebola happened in the US, I had to travel to another city to lecture. You know what they told me? They said, you're coming from a hot zone. We've canceled lecture or meeting people from the hot zone. We had one case, right? One case of Ebola. So that was an overkill. Can we do that today? The whole world is a SARS hot zone.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Then think about other work practice controls clinically. Okay. Wash your hands between, gloving, when you walk in. Don't touch spaces unnecessarily. Unnecessary spaces, don't touch it. Don't touch surfaces which don't have a barrier. Don't touch surfaces with contaminated gloves. Wear a regular mask. I mean, I'm fine with a regular mask.
So I'm going to ask you that because there's a question from the audience right now. So let's just go through that. There's a lot of questions and they're all kind of similar. So I'm going to kind of present to you all at once. This question here is, do the N95 masks keep us safe from the virus particles?
Okay. When they say N95, are you being specific to a respirator with a filter, with a 95% filtration rate of particles? Okay. Now, people get confused between a normal mask. Then they've gone ahead and unnecessarily classified into level 1, level 2, level 3 masks. For dentistry, you have a mask. Okay. The most common mask is the same. Remember that ugly, cheap yellow mask we used to use in school?
Mm-hmm.
Even that'll work. The issue is, when they say N95, the filtration capacity, it's the material's filtration capacity, not the mask as a whole. So if you really want N95 to work, okay, it has to have an adequate face fit with a silicone face fit, and the air has to go through the mask, the front of the mask, okay, the material of the mask. None of these masks, unless you wear a respirator, mm-hmm, with the HEPA filters and a snug face fit, those are going to be useful in a situation like this. A regular mask, all it does is it prevents you from sneezing or coughing on somebody. It prevents other people coughing on you. The size of the particulate matter varies. Okay. Now, this actually leads to the next question you'll probably ask me.
Yeah.
When there's something called a droplet, and then there are smaller particles. Okay. A droplet is 5 microns or wider in diameter, and normally it is gravity dependent. So when they used to say, stay away 3 to 6 feet from a person, that is the cough or sneeze distance before it can settle on you.
Right.
The 5 micron particles or more. Then when you cough, you generate both. You don't just generate a 5 micron particle droplets only. You'll generate smaller particles that can stay suspended in the air, and they're not dependent on gravity. You see? So what happens is, the mask which we use in dentistry is good enough for a splash or spatter, the particulate matter falling. But airborne particulates go through the side, through the top, through the bottom, and that's called blow-by. Okay. Now, the issue is, there was only one person, and I mean, there's one person who actually came out, the head of SIDRAP, Dr. Michael Hosterholm. He was the first guy who said, whenever this happens, you'll normally have an airborne issue. And today everybody's talking about it being airborne. So you cannot control yourself, control the spread with a general dental mask. You have to either use a respirator. The downside of that is, wear a respirator or a painter's mask with a snug face fit. and work on a patient for 15 minutes, you'll go red in the face within 15 minutes. I used them in the past.
So let's bring that up, because there's some people who talked about that using respirators. You know, obviously there's some colleagues that practice holistic dentistry. They wear the respirators as well. And I even asked you, I was like, is that going to be a new norm? Do we have to start wearing those respirators there? And you were saying, Glenn, after 15 minutes, it's going to be hard for you to breathe.
Until and unless it's a positive air pressure respirator, those are the ones where they have actually a power module on your back. And then the air goes in from here. It goes through a HEPA filter, and then it provides you fresh air. And that is, you know, powered, and that you can breathe in. That's used for Ebola and the other stuff.
Right. Okay.
I haven't used one. I've seen those.
Yeah. Now, let me go back to, so, you know, thank you for kind of explaining all that. But let me go back to, well, okay, you're saying that just using a regular mask should be sufficient because it's more of a droplet, what we're concerned about. So as far as what patients we can see, because that's what's on everyone's mind. I think everyone is right. Okay with shutting down for 2 to 3 weeks. And there's going to be some of us that beyond 3 weeks is going to be very hard for us financially and economically, right?
Of course. Of course, you have to run, you know, the profession, the business end of it is expensive. It's not cheap.
Right. Let's fast forward and it gets to that point. And now we need to start seeing patients. Number one, what are the things, precautions we need to take? Who can we see and what are the things that we can do? Because, emergency patients, right? That's what they say. Emergency situations. That is such a broad term because, exactly. You know, I had a patient who literally told me that his teeth were sensitive. He needed to get some fillings done. I said, hey, look, you know, only emergency. He's like, this is bothering me. It's kind of an emergency for me. And I told him, well, let's give it a couple of weeks, right? But there's patients there that actually want to come in. They feel fine. And, you know, depending on someone's pain tolerance, I mean, what is really classified as an emergency? That's number one. Number two, what about our hygiene department? What about our hygienists who have been so crucial to our practice and they can't work? Like, what's going to happen there? So, Dr. Puttaiah, can you go through the things that we can do without putting us and our team at risk?
Okay. So, number one, most procedures which involve splash or spatter, try and reduce that. Hygiene, I would say, you know, no polishing, no ultrasonic until and unless you have a clip-on, you know, suction right at the tip, and you do it. You can use hand instruments. There's nothing wrong in that.
So hand instruments, okay. Hand scaling.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. Now, in other dental stuff, you can't until and unless it's ART for a little kids. You know what do you call? Deciduous tooths, you know, scraping out. You can probably do that with hand instruments, but most of the time you have to use a burr. Okay, so you have to have devices that work right at the site where you're generating the bioaerosols. Okay, so there are many devices in the market. I mean, these are engineering controls. You know, we'll come to that. Now, classifying what's an emergency if they are in severe pain, real acute pain. That could lead to an abscess. Number one, have a quick look in the mouth. It's a dry look. If you feel that they need to be put on antibiotics and you can postpone it, that's great. If they need to be, it needs to be extracted, you know, go ahead and extract it, but don't do surgical extraction because you still need to use a handpiece. You still need to use a coolant for that, you know, a water source for that. So the general items such as disease control, basic disease control, you don't need to do that. Okay, until unless it's a bombed out tooth, then you can kind of go ahead and do a pulpectomy. Go ahead and do that.
Okay.
So you can still do other stuff. If it's a fractured tooth, you may not be able to save it. You have to decide whether you're going to pull it or whether you're going to crown it. To crown it, you'll have to still go ahead and, you know, prep it. So that's another big thing. So there are gray areas, but by and large, general dental stuff, which you can avoid too long an exposure, you can do that. The other thing is four-handled dentistry. Make sure you got your assistant having the HVE, high volume evacuator, right where you're generating it. Make sure if you're going to be doing any larger prep kind of a thing, you have your rubber dam on.
Okay.
That reduces bioaerosols.
So rubber dam. So
I hate it, but I love
back
it.
Back to school. Start rubber damming people. Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I'm not saying that's the end all of it. So there are many things you can still do. You know, regular dentures, you know, making impressions, making, you know, taking your measurements, you know, bottom sealing and all those things, bottom molding, all those things you can still do. The caveat is
the biggest thing is the aerosols.
Exactly. Now, you have two options. You can have your two options must be followed simultaneously. One is using a high volume evacuator. They have different kinds of heads.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they have wider spout heads to smaller regular HVE tips. Then you have engineering controls which are built in into your system, into your HVAC, or there are devices that actually have they suck in air, ambient air, through a HEPA and multi-layer filter into an UV chamber,
I sent you that link of that unit.
I saw one. Yeah, in fact,
is that something that could help as well? I can put the link in there for everyone who's watching.
You can see what I actually in my earlier this morning I finished a podcast for the American Society of Cosmetic Dentistry. I suggested two things which I just pulled off of the hat. One is surgically clean air. I think they have a really nice system and they've been setting up for quite a few of our students. And one of the students actually told me what she had got. And that's when I kind of got onto that to see.
Okay.
Then there is another one. It is RGE or something it is called. They all have centralized systems to portable systems. We need to use them.
Okay.
You know, when we go through this OSHA training, they'll say, work practice control and engineering controls. This is a true engineering control, which actually circulates cleaner air within your clinic, and it gets rid of the bioaerosols. I mean, at least to about 95%. So that's a pretty good start.
Yeah. I'm glad you brought that up, Dr. Puttaiah, because that's something I've been spending a lot of time just reaching out to different manufacturers that can provide this purified air. Anything that we can do to make it safer for not only, I mean, really for our patients, but for us with all this stuff flying in the air. So I guess what you just said there is basically we want to limit, right? The amount of aerosols that we produce. Okay. Now, obviously, if you're doing an extraction and you're halfway done and you do need to pull out that handpiece, I mean, it is what it is. But I think, Dr. Puttaiah, you're saying like if you're not just going to go in there and prep like, six veneers, okay? You're not going to be doing that, okay? More emergency, but things limit the, and I think that's something to think about when we, because we had someone here and their question is, assuming this goes on for months, at some point elective procedures get a green light and should we be seeing high-risk patients? And I think you just said that too, is that we have businesses to run and it's all about just limiting the risks, right? And I think once it gets to that point, not too much aerosols. But this goes to another thing too. What about prepping the patient? We have someone asking a question here. And is it true that hydrogen peroxide reduces the viral load? I've told that to have patients swish for about a minute. What are your thoughts on that? And Dr. Puttaiah, we had talked about this earlier.
Right. See, basically it's RNA enveloped virus. Basically, these are the easier ones to kill. Okay. You have enveloped and non-enveloped viruses. The non-enveloped viruses like rotavirus and poliovirus, they are harder to kill. Enveloped virus like this one, influenza, HIV, they are easier. I mean, to kill them is very easy. Mm-hmm. You can use a hydrogen peroxide, not more than 1% in concentration, please, because it comes in 3% from a grocery store. It's inexpensive. It works. You can use clothexidine. You can use your either an alcohol-based Listerine or whatever. Yeah, those things kill. I would prefer everybody, you know, in infection control, I've said, the first thing the patient has to do once they come in into your clinic is get a pre-procedural mouth rinse.
Mm-hmm.
We always knew that, you know.
Yeah.
A few people follow it, a few people forget it, you know. So yeah, it's a good idea. And if this goes on forever, yes, this condition goes on forever, or this epidemic, sure, they will have to. Right now, the rules are not rigid that you must close your clinics down. These are guidelines.
Right.
You know. So now just think about it. You know, who are the ones who don't have any fever or anything? These are children. Think about the poor orthodontists out there who are going to be suffering. They've considered changing, you know, what do you call the monthly thing is not an emergency situation. The kids can stay with their bands until and unless, you know, a band or a bracket breaks. Only then they come in. But how long and how far can one go on with this? See, every health profession has to go on. What if tomorrow all the hospitals shut down? What if the pharmacies shut down? Mm-hmm. What if the groceries shut down? I mean, life goes on. It happened over right from, you know, 500 BC till now. We've been hit with multiple types of plagues and epidemics that have killed people and killed people. You know, right now we don't have a vaccine for this, but I'm sure within a few months to a year or so, we'll have a decent vaccine incorporated into the next flu strain or whatever it is. Those will be available, you know. So it's going to change for the better, but don't freak out. Be cautious and be comfortable. That's my thoughts on that, you know.
And that's great advice. And like I said, when you told me that earlier today, I felt a lot better, because the thing is that we have to assume that this could be like a new norm. It's a possibility, right? And so the new norm being, well, maybe before you weren't doing pre-appointment rinses, now you're going to do it, right? And you just mentioned a few rinses. Someone had just posted here. They're like, I can't find hydrogen peroxide. They're like worried here. But you were just saying that you don't have to use hydrogen peroxide. And mention again, what are the pre-rinses that you would recommend?
You know, the best pre-rinse is a 2% chlorhexidine gluconate. Yeah, that's the, like Peridex equivalent, okay? Those are expensive. The next one, you can go for Listerine. Anything with a little bit of alcohol in it. You know, alcohol is used as a preservative. And these things die with, even if most preservatives, alcohol levels are between 13 to 27%. But when they say 27%, it's more than 30%. You know, it's almost, that's why, like in the old movies, there were little kids running away with mouthwash to go and swig it.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Those things will kill. So it can be hydrogen peroxide, it can be chlorhexidine, it can be Listerine. I'm just stating it can be Equate brand from Walmart, it can be Target brand. So these will work, you know.
Yeah, so I am, you know, we have all these questions coming in. So guys, I want to get to all your questions, okay? This one here, what if we are in a shelter, in a home mandated, like the sheltered area in a certain county, they mandated that. We have a bunch of patients with temp cramps. I'm concerned about it holding up. But I think you were saying that as long as we're not producing aerosols, I mean, seating a crown is safe?
Sure. For a temp crown, I don't see any prep being done. You'll probably use a hand instrument to clean out that area, remove the cement, you know, get a new crown in, put some cement and send them. Or this is the time to use SDF. Silver diamine fluoride. Why not?
Yeah, I guess if you have a lot of pedo patients, that's the time to do it, right? Yeah, for sure. Right. I don't know about having adult patients wanting to have their tooth get stained dark or black.
Well, we won't be putting a silver crown, you know, the crimped old crown to an older patient anyways.
All right. So we got a bunch of other questions, Dr. Puttaiah. Guys, thank you so much for tuning in. I mean, there's a lot of people on here, and Dr. Puttaiah is here to answer our questions and really put our minds at ease. And like I said, I kind of started this by saying that this could be like a new norm for us, right? We have to be ready for it. And that means that we might have to do practice dentistry just a little bit different. And I even talked to Dr. Puttaiah, I mean, down to the, I even asked him, like, do I need to buy some respirators? Like, is it going to get to that point? But then again, you said, Dr. Puttaiah, those respirators could be very uncomfortable. But, you know, just reducing the aerosols is really going to help. Having them use the pre-rinse, reducing the amount of times that you're going to create the aerosols, and making sure, right? It's all about case selection, right? You guys love that term.
Get a triage.
Right? Someone's sick, don't see them. Hey, if they're okay, you can bring them in. Don't have a whole bunch of people in your office. Add different things like an air purifier, like surgical clean air. I mean, I know someone just put the comment link in there. And guys, I'm talking to them right now. I'm going to try to work out a deal.
That's a good thing.
It's a good thing. I have friends who are not even in holistic dentistry, and they're just like us, and they love using it. Okay, so it kills viral particles, and so we're going to look into that. So, Dr. Puttaiah, let me look here. We got some more questions here. Okay, so we were talking about cementing crowns, right? And you know, this doctor asked, "Well, what about occlusal adjustments that generates aerosols?" And I think you just answered your own question. It says, guess pre-cementation adjustments would reduce the chance. Yeah. Well, yeah, you're not gonna adjust in their mouth. Okay. You're gonna adjust it out of there. And depending on, you know, what kind of practice you have, I actually, in my lab, I have a huge evacuation unit. I'll just do it right in front of the vacuum, adjust the crown there if you're worried about it. Dr. Puttaiah, let's say if someone doesn't have that and they need to adjust the crown, would you say possibly just like dipping it in Paradex or chlorhexidine before you start adjusting it? What do you think?
You know, this is something which I've talked about in the past. If you want to generate bioaerosols, use a chlorhexidine as a coolant.
Okay.
You know, in your bottle, put in chlorhexidine. Okay. You get Mintaclean, which is this Mintaclean, I think, is the you know, waterline cleaning agent, and it's also a chlorhexidine. Then you can use that. I mean, don't use that Miltaclean per se, but you can use chlorhexidine, you know, as an irrigant. And that should be better than using nice water. Or if you can use, you know, a burr without any a coolant, water coolant, and do it slowly. And that can work too.
Okay. Yeah. Let me ask you this. What about if in hygiene, you know, sometimes certain Cavitrons have their own, like they put Paradex in there. What if they use the Cavitron with the Paradex?
That should work too, but it also depends.
It's expensive. It can get expensive, but.
No, they use it as an irrigant, and there's a charge for that, which they use, you know, for perio. I'm sure that should work too, because even that is actually equivalent to a Paradex concentration. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I don't see anything wrong in that. I mean, people can say that I'm wrong, and I could be wrong, but think about it pragmatically. If it can kill 90% of the microbes in your mouth and hold it out for 60 to 90 minutes based on the studies which were done in the late 80s to the mid 90s, you know, by real good researchers, hey, that's the way to go. I would go and do that, you know, but I would make sure that somebody's, even a hygienist will need somebody for evacuation to use.
So assisted hygiene.
Correct. No, it will be. I mean, things are changing and we have to adapt, you know. I mean, and think about it. A hygienist has got a job to do. They have bills to pay.
Yeah.
What if they have to sit at home? But they can come and they have support where their kids can be taken care of, but they can come to work. I mean, you got to watch a podcast by Michael Osterholm. He really talks about if all the, you know, what do you call, you know, daycare shelters for the kids, the daycare places for the kids close down, half the doctors and nurses cannot go to the hospital. Can you imagine? So the machinery has to be oiled. You have to move it cautiously. These are cautious times, you know.
And, you know, I want to before I take this next question, I want you to kind of reiterate that, because we had that conversation. We said, I told him, Dr. Puttaiah, I told you, I was like, I don't think it's this 3 weeks this thing is going to go longer than 3 weeks. And at some point, we got to get back to our practices. At some point, we have to resume some kind of normalcy, right?
See, I tell you, in November, when I posted this thing, November of last year, I posted this, something similar to SARS is hitting Wuhan. And yeah. I'm not joking. Some of the people whom I know personally made fun of me. And then there were people taking jabs at me whom I didn't even know from. And then they kept saying, okay, so what is it like? I said, it starts off like a flu. And then they started making fun of me. And look at it today. And I know who those people are. But, you know, sometimes I make fun of people. The next day, I might be in a wheelchair. Who knows?
So here's a question that is that actually applies to you, Dr. Puttaiah. So I'm going to put it up.
Oh, my God.
Should I shave my facial hair?
Well, if you're... if you have facial hair like me, I would wash it about four times a day, like, you know, because, you know, basically you have more surface area for microbes to settle. Okay. And normally people with beards have more bugs on their face. And I have one too, and I've had it for a long time.
Yeah.
I have to wash my beard every day. I have to wash my beard. Every time I go wash my face, I wash my beard.
Okay.
But if you want to wear a respirator, you cannot have this beard. It has to be shaven out.
That's something.
There will not be a face.
And I think that's something very important to say, because I know some people who do wear respirators and they have bigger beards than you. So I hope they're watching this. They need shave. Yeah. So look, you got two choices here, basically. Okay. You want to keep your beard? You got to clean out your beard a lot. Okay.
No, the choices are very... very clear out here. One, you can look like Glenn, or one, you can look like me.
That's right.
A beard, if you're going to use a respirator, a beard's not going to help. Normally in surgical situations, you know, and most of us do surgeries, people are expected to wear a beard mask, a beard net or a mask, it's called. It's a mask and it covers all the way down to here. We used to use that in India a long time ago.
Yeah.
Especially when we had to go do third molar extractions and stuff. Yeah.
So, Dr. Rab, we got some more questions here. And guys, thank you. Keep the questions coming. If you have any questions or comments, this one is they're the same question, but I'm going to ask you. Is an isolite, will that be able to work? Is that a good alternative to a rubber dam? I know some restorative docs who have strong opinions on this. But let me ask you, Dr. Puttaiah. What if they use isolite? Can that help? And would that be enough? Or is that just kind of helping a little bit?
Helping a little bit. It makes a lot of noise. I've never seen rubber dam making noise. Mm-hmm. It makes a lot of noise. You know, I basically wouldn't like to sit beside an isolate. I would rather have somebody with HVE sucking it out as and when needed. Isolite is good if it's, you know, just a two-handed dentistry. It's very good in one way, because it reduces you having an assistant in place while doing stuff, you know, for certain things. So yes and no, but I prefer a 400 dentistry, and I prefer actually
the rubber dam.
Rubber dam and external things which can suck the bioaerosols away as well.
Yeah. So guys, again, like I said, what Dr. Puttaiah recommended earlier is rubber dam over isolite and a air purifier or air evacuation unit of some sort. I'll post those links later. There's a couple of units I've been looking at personally. And I had some friends who used an air purifier in their practice, and they were using this way before this has happened. And they said that the quality of air is so much better. Their allergies don't act up. Patients comment on it. I will say this, it's not cheap. And that's why I really want to work a nifty deal for all of us here. So we got another question here, and it goes back to the Paradex, Dr. Puttaiah. And so this doctor is asking, well, if you dilute the Paradex, do you dilute the Paradex before putting it in the bottles? And also, will Paradex clog up the lines?
No. I've actually done over 50 waterline studies, both federally and industry funded. Paradex does not clog up the line. In fact, Paradex is actually good. You do not dilute it. The least I would dilute it is to 0.12%.
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty much like 0.2%. They've changed all the 0.12% to 0.2%, but I wouldn't go lower than that, and that's okay. You know, I mean, what's the cost of a Peridex bottle? You know, if you buy it for commercial use as a professional, it's cheaper, right?
Right.
And you can probably tag that much onto, you know, the filling, or be thankful at least the patient came in and you could do a bunch of fillings.
Right. I mean, at the end of the day, I think it's whatever the
it
cost
pays for itself. Yeah.
The whatever the cost is, it's better than not even being open. Right.
Yeah.
You also said too that something like a Listerine is effective too, like that strong alcohol as well. So it could be something where you kind of use both, right?
You could, but I did try testing Listerine. It works, but it's never been used as an irrigant.
Oh, no, I meant like a pre-rinse using the Listerine.
Instead of both. A Listerine, the only difference between what I've seen in the previous studies, you know, done by pretty much the big guys when I was in school or doing my postdoctoral fellowship, was chlorhexidine has got, you know, it sticks to your soft tissue.
Right.
Okay. Listerine does not. So chlorhexidine acts for a longer period of time.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's the only difference. And I don't think you should be doing a 90-minute procedure on a patient just because chlorhexidine is working, you know.
Yeah.
So Listerine should work, you know.
Yeah, so that's good advice there. I mean, if it's going to be a long procedure, you might want to rethink that, right? You want to do something. You said you use as 90 minutes kind of like the standard, like you got to do it less than 90 minutes?
No. What I was saying was...
Oh, you're saying chlorhexidine.
Peridex, not lasting, you know.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So we have another question here. And guys, thank you so much for tuning in. Like I said, this is very important that we hear this from a colleague and a professional who knows what they're talking about, and not CNN and not Fox News. Okay. Some real science behind this. We have a question here, and this is, what about reusing these N95 masks?
You have two different types. If you have to use, I mean, you get two different types of N95 masks. There are masks which come as a shell, and then you attach the filtration units to it, and it's made of hard plastic. Those are reusable, but you can change out the filters as needed.
Mm-hmm.
The other ones, like the painter's mask, which they call it the N95 mask.
Yeah.
The minute you contaminate it, or you feel it's contaminated, dispose of it. I wouldn't keep it for more than half a day or a day. Yeah, I mean, max. And another thing is, take your gloves off, put your hands behind, and then remove it. Don't try to grab the glove with or without, I mean, the mask with or without your gloves, you know, whether it's contaminated or not.
Because you just get it on your hands.
You get it on your hands, you know. Yeah. The other one, you could decontaminate it. In fact, you know, I used to have three of the same type of different filters, because if I had to go and see four or five patients, you know, in the negative air pressure rooms, these were, you know, patients with AIDS and TB. You know, this was in the Bexar County Hospital when I used to do my rotations. Every Friday we used to go on infectious disease rotations, and I had to go look up. And I tell you one thing, I used to keep one outside, because the minute you come out of the air pressure, negative air pressure room, they'll ask you to get rid of all your PPE.
Mm-hmm.
And they used to provide the you know, the painter's mask, as I call them painter's mask, you know. Yeah, those I used to throw. But then after a while, when I'd been to the APIC meeting, I got a few samples of the same type of respirators. And all I had to do was buy filters, you know. So those have to be reprocessed. And it takes a lot to reprocess it, actually.
And, you know, like someone had just already mentioned this, there's a shortage in those masks. So if there's a shortage in those masks and all we have is our regular masks that we've been wearing, is that going to be sufficient for the guidelines you just put down? Because obviously, if you're not generating a lot of aerosols, your regular mask that you've been wearing is okay.
It is okay. But what I'm saying is, whenever you wear any mask, make sure it has a good fit.
Okay.
Adapt it tightly to your face. There are different types of masks available. You know, one of my favorites was quite expensive. It used to They used to call it the duckbill mask. I don't know. It was being made by Technol at one time, I think, before Kimberly-Clark. This was around the time when you were in school. We were evaluating all the things. We were changing over from latex to non-latex. Do you remember that? And I was sending out the forms for people to evaluate and fill. And that was the time when this duckbill mask was there. But all of a sudden, it disappeared. That used to have a fairly decent face fit. But try and adapt it to your face as well as possible.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So obviously, if you can get your hands on an N95 mask, that would be ideal. But it's all about all those things you brought up, right? Case selection, right? Case selection, making sure you do the pre-rinse. Do the pre-rinse, right? Follow, you know, normal infection control protocols and limit the amount of aerosols.
Correct. Yeah.
It's all those things together. You can't just, and you know, if you can add some extra things like air filtration and whatnot, those are all bonus.
No, I would seriously consider people to equip their practices with the engineering controls, you know, the air scrubbers. Those are really good.
Okay.
I mean, a lot of my friends have been using them because some have kids with asthma and other respiratory conditions. And those are, they really have made a difference in them.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, it's all those things there, but I think it boils down to the most obvious thing that we should be doing. That is, you know, it's the case selection. That I think that trumps over everything. You can have, you can wear a respirator for all I care, but like if you're, you know, it's all about case selection.
Sure. Communication, you know, be proactive in communicating with your patients, you know, and letting them know not to come if they're not feeling well. Same thing applies to your staff as well. If they're not feeling well, don't come. It's okay. You know, somebody will take the slack for the day because, you know, it's a cycle. Today, somebody falls sick. Tomorrow, you'll fall sick, you know. So, yeah, I mean.
So we, this question kind of brought a smile to my face, but hey, it is a somewhat serious question. What if you wear two masks?
Well,
what if you wear two masks and like just cover like almost all your face?
I've seen one person wear two masks, but the problem was he had two heads. You know, it's like Jack the Giant Killer, the giant with one head, and then his little buddy with the. Yeah, that guy could wear two masks. Two masks will not really make a difference because the blow-by is going to be there anyways.
Okay.
It blows through the side. Yeah.
Okay. And then we had another question. I was trying to look for it. I kind of got lost here. And it's about the chlorhexidine. What percent did you recommend again?
It used to come in 0.12, but I think it comes as a 2% chlorhexidine. I mean, 0.2%, I think it is.
0.2.
Point two, because it's a mouthwash. It's
See
that hand soaps are 2% and 4%.
Okay, because someone this question was they thought it what you said 2%.
No, it's point two.
Point two.
It used to be dispensed as 0.12%, but then they upped it to 0.2% later.
Yeah. Okay. And then Amy Burney from class of 05, you probably remember her. She caused a lot of trouble with RuPaul a lot that class. They love to haze my class 2 years behind them. So I remember them very fondly. But anyway, she just asked, how am I supposed to put a rubber dam on a tooth number two? It's hard to get the clamp on there. And I say maybe you should just reschedule them until this blows over. But what do you say, Dr. Puttaiah, for Amy?
Difficult. Actually, I still remember when I was in school, they were making us put the rubber dam, the clamps on. And one actually struck, it bounced off. I mean, it kind of came off. It hit his lower tooth. And the guy was in severe pain.
Wow. So
I don't know. I mean, it all depends on the shape. Sometimes you can't get a clamp on a particular tooth, dependent on the shape.
Right.
The older the patient, it's easier to get. The younger the patient, you know, especially teens and so on, it's hard.
Yeah. No, I agree. And hopefully it's something, Amy, that you can wait on.
Hey, I've retired. Don't ask me those clinical questions anymore. Plus, I was in diagnostics. Come on.
Yeah. No, well, she just said it's a crown after endo that's coming in on Monday.
Oh my God. Okay. Ask her to be very, very careful.
Amy, be very careful. Like extremely careful.
No, that I know. I mean, that's ask her to use chlorhexidine, you know, to do the prep, or you know, at least do something like a buildup and send the patient back.
Yeah.
You know, for that.
Yeah. So,
or you can put a band. Ask her to put a band around the tooth, do the buildup, reduce it as much as you can, get it off occlusion, send the patient off. You don't have to finish the prep that day.
Okay.
Now, you should do that, yeah, before.
Yeah, we have another question here. This is kind of the question that I asked you, and everyone's thinking about it. But they want to know, when do you think that this will kind of die down and be, and everything's going to be back to normal again? How long do you think?
Well, you know, whoever asked that question, ask them to pinch themselves and see if they're in a dream. I can tell you possibly next year how long this epidemic will last based on what it lasted this year.
Yeah.
You can't model. That's why they call it a novel coronavirus, because even the virologists don't know how it's going to happen.
Well, let me ask you this. I mean, it took China about 2 months to get through this. I mean, now they're having more than 2 months.
November it started.
November.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's right. You said that earlier.
And it wasn't an easy thing for them. And what they've done compared to what they did for SARS, this is like amazing good. I mean, people always complain about governments. But hey, let me tell you, kudos to them. They have a huge population. They have lesser per capita money. But whatever they did, they've kind of, you know what you call, they're doing the best to flatten it out. And that's pretty good.
So if you said November, that's like 4 or 5 months.
4 months.
4 months.
Yeah, end of November is when it started. The cases started coming. Yeah.
And you would say the height of coronavirus here is like, you would say like right now possibly, or we haven't even hit the tipping point yet?
I hope it is now. I hope it is now. It's not reached the tipping point yet. That's what I feel. If you look at the case increases, you know, it's an exponential case increase, even today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every day I make my chart, I have to go and change it for my podcast. And that's a pain because the number of cases keep going up. The number of deaths keep going up. You know, it is going to hit the vulnerable population, even probably in a month or two or three.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
So based on that trajectory, now what I'm hoping, and I think you're hoping too, that maybe we've learned from other people and we're putting protocols in faster and whatnot. But based on how long it took China to get through it, we're looking at June.
Hopefully not that long. I mean, I'm cautiously hopeful it'll be early,
mm-hmm.
earlier than that. But think about this. We are dentists. We are dental professionals. We are hygienists. We are assistants. We get a beating on infection control and OSHA. Think about that. You know, you go into a medical doctor's office, how much of splash and spatter is there? How much of swapping spit is there? Hardly any. We are used to a much higher level. We sterilize a lot more devices than anybody else in the world.
Right.
We do. We use a lot more barriers. We use a lot more disinfectants. We use a much higher amount of engineering controls than any other profession uses other than manufacturing, you know. And we do a lot of metal work. We do a lot of ceramic stuff. We generate even particulate matter, not even aerosols, particulate, dry, mist, dust. And we've had better devices to control this. And the only thing is we are human and we freak out.
Yeah.
And don't expect the government, I mean, don't expect the American Dental Association or TDA to come and, you know, impose sanctions on you. They don't. They don't want to scare anybody up. And at the same time, they want to be cautious, because if they go overboard, you know, they have a lot to lose if they do an undercall, they have a lot to lose. So they have to walk a fine line.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can talk about this and I can say that, you know, don't have to be really scared. It's not diphtheria. You know, diphtheria has much higher kill rate and a spread rate.
Mm-hmm.
It is not measles. It is not mumps. It's not rubella. It is a different kind of a virus. You know, we go through a lot of vaccines, you know, through our life, immunization. Probably, you know, this is much lower than some of the ones we get. We go through the childhood vaccinations.
Dr. Puttaiah, let me ask you this question before it disappears, because these questions are going really fast. And that is, this doctor just said that the CDC just loosened its recommendation for N95 masks to regular surgical masks as effective for preventing infection. Do you agree with that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. I mean, I'm not saying that just because CDC said, but that is what I've been always telling.
Yeah, you've been saying that this whole time. Everyone's saying about N95, and it's not just the mask. It's all those things that you have to lead up to right before you put your mask on.
Exactly. And you know what? Even CDC is very cautious in saying that, because of course, even in our profession, we'll have people, oh yeah, it's okay. I am wearing a mask. I'm not even going to do, I'm going to create splash or spatter. There will be some gung-ho people also. So they're afraid of, you know, one or two kind of getting hurt, but they have to be careful. They must treat patients.
Yes.
Patients rely on us. We rely on them. So, you know, nothing should come to a grinding halt. It should move on. It could move on cautiously, you know. So that's what I would say.
So Rupal is asking a question here. And like I said, I am so sorry if I missed your question, because these are going really fast. I'm trying to keep up with them. But you, I guess she had a question about easing the fears of their team members. And what are, obviously, you're helping us out here, but what can we say to our team members to ease their fears about seeing patients?
Just tell them, if they don't listen to you, they're going to take a class with Puttaiah for free, of course, for 8 hours without a break. No, let me tell you, you guys are your leaders, okay? You guys manage your profession, your clinic. Here's a professional service. You're licensed people. You're the tip. You're the top, you're the crown. You got to not only try and convince them, you got to educate them. You know enough to educate them, you know. Allay the fears. I mean, be there to help them. Don't freak them out. Don't have to be angry with them. But tell them, guys, this is the reason why we are doing this. You know, and by the way, even if they have to go on vacation, go on staycation because the government said it's going to allow X amount of money. You think the government is going to keep doing this till July? No way.
Yeah, they're not.
No, they're not. So what we earn is what we take. And let's give them a safety net as well. You know, we're not trying to make them, we're not forcing them to come, but we'd love to have them come. If they're not feeling well, we'd love for them to stay home.
Yeah. You know? No, I agree. Yeah. Thank you so much for that. And that's what I did with my team too. I told them, I was like, I'm not going to force anyone to be here. We're going to work. We're going to, you know, we had to make some sacrifices in my office. I told everyone I had to cut their hours and whatnot, but the goal was to keep them as part of the team. So, I totally agree with that, Dr. Puttaiah. You just
I've got to add something to that. I know how you build your team. So guys, here's what happened. One day I landed up in Glenn's office and he had a team building practice going on. And the next day somebody was supposed to clean the whole office. And then he made them play Jenga. The person who lost in Jenga was the one who had to stay back the next day and clean the office. That's how he makes
you gotta keep it fun, Dr. Puttaiah. You gotta keep it fun right there. Okay, so we got a few more questions here, and
well, yeah.
Rupal, did I butcher your name? I'm so sorry. I'm so used to it. When I see you, Rupal. I just say what's up, you know, like she's mad as I'm butchering her name. Hey, I don't butcher your husband's name. I mean, Ash is very easy. My son loves Pokemon. He knows all about Ash. Okay, so there's a, hold on. Okay, this is really important. I need to bring this up. I'm going to answer it, and Dr. Puttaiah, you're going to answer it too. So Nala just said that we need to abide by the recommendations of the White House, right? Of us, you know, staying home and not going out and social distancing, quarantining, all that good stuff, right? And so I'm going to answer that. I'm going to answer it by this. We're not going out and going to the beach and Clearwater Beach and having a good time. No, we're going to our office to take care of people because we're healthcare professionals, okay? I think even areas where it's locked down, you can go to a healthcare professional. You go to the grocery store, you can go get gas, you can see, go to the healthcare professional. We are healthcare professionals, okay? So no, it's not a green light to go around and go to Clearwater Beach and have fun on the beach or anything like that. No, you go to your office to take care of patients. That's what I'm doing. I'm going to my office, take care of my patient, and then I go home when there's no one else around, okay? So that I'm gonna answer your question there about as far as if we need to abide by what the White House says. Yeah, we do. But we're healthcare professionals and we're here to help out patients. Dr. Puttaiah, what do you say to that?
See, even the White House has to bank on what the CDC, CIDRAP, the FDA, NIH, National Institute of Allergies and Infectious Diseases, Anthony Fauci. These guys, they have a team of people. I mean, it doesn't matter whether it's Trump or, you know, Bush or whoever it is. They have to rely on their advisors before they come up with a policy statement. Yes, if they say you're not supposed to walk into this military facility, I would say yes. But I don't think they will ever say, tell dentists and healthcare professionals not to go about doing, you know, to go about and not do their job as such. Until and unless, you know, they'll say, yeah, of course. If it's going to be a very high risk job, refer them to a tertiary center. They have different levels. Now, let me tell you one thing. We are talking in a metroplex, most of us. Think about the guys in the rural areas. If you're a dentist, you know, outside of Justin, Texas or something, you're it.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, so can they just stand by and see somebody in pain just because the White House said that? No, it's a good Samaritan thing. And even the White House won't pick on anybody for doing a good thing. So, yeah.
I love that. Well, Dr. Puttaiah, thank you so much for jumping on. This went way longer than I thought. Everyone came to talk to you, and thank you so much. Now, a few people actually requested that I bring you back on maybe in a couple of weeks for an update. So would you be okay doing that?
Sure.
Hopefully by then we'll be talking about something more fun instead of this right now. But Dr. Puttaiah, again, thank you so much for jumping on. And before we jump off, I'll let you have the last words in context to what's going on in our country right now from COVID-19.
I have seen this during SARS. I've seen this during H1N1, you know, the swine flu. I've seen this going on during the Ebola, the case of Ebola we had in Dallas, Texas. Yeah, these things are not here to stay, but they're not going to stop coming. Use your best infection control knowledge. You know, use your best educated judgment, you know, your professional judgment. And don't think that just because you stay home, you're not going to fall sick. You know, you're better off falling sick because of a clinical exposure. That's what I think. And yeah, so it's going to be here, but stay calm. Don't think that it's going to stay on forever. You're going to get back to your clinic and work when you feel comfortable. If you have someone sick at home or somebody vulnerable at home, then you may want to hold back. But that also, even within your house, you can sequester yourself. If you fall sick, go upstairs or go to a separate room. You know, carry a stick with you and stay you know, 6 feet away from them. You know, that helps too. I mean, I'm not joking.
Yeah.
You don't go and keep giving a sick man a hug. You only give dying people a hug. So,
yeah. Dr. Puttaiah, again, thank you so much for jumping on. And guys, I know a bunch of you guys asked, like, how can I get a hold of this Facebook Live? I'm actually going to post this on the Nifty Thrifty Dentist Facebook page. This is in the group, okay? The group, only people in the group can actually see this. So if you want your team to watch it, you can always add them to the group. But if you don't want them in the group because we talk about them sometimes, I'm going to put it on the Facebook page. And from there, you can share it anywhere you want. So please share that with your team for those who have team members who are concerned. And again, like all Facebook Lives, this is going to be converted to a podcast form. So for those who jumped on later and you don't want to just sit here and watch us and look at us, you can listen to it on a podcast while you're driving around town looking for toilet paper. So anyways, Dr. Puttaiah, thank you so much for jumping on. And guys, we will see you next time.
Thanks. Bye-bye.